or do it themselves. Hey, so this guy's got a CD player, a whole rack of CDs sitting on the back seat. You know, go get this card, it's right here at this address. You know, whatever. But that's what happened. And my wallet was in the glove box, and they'd used a screwdriver to open my door and a screwdriver to pry open the glove box, and they stole my wallet. There was nothing in it. And I don't use debt cards and all of that other fraudulent crap out there. So I just had, you know, pieces of ID. And that was one of them that was gone. So I thought, oh, I'm not going to go through all that hassle, you know, and enter another unilateral contract. And you know what that is, a unilateral contract?
One-sided.
All the contracts you've entered with the government have been only your signature. How do you do that? I mean, then I'm the only one entering this contract, and I'm the only one bound by the terms and conditions of it. Hey, wait a minute, I like that. And I'm the only one who could break it. Uh-huh, because all those types of contracts are null and void. They're not valid contracts. A contract is an agreement between two or more people. And if there isn't autographs on there of two people, both in position to accept legal liability, you know, for both sides in the contract, it's not a valid contract. It's that simple. But they got you applying for everything that way. You know, social insurance card or whatever it be, passport.
Student loan. You know,
student loans, you know, whatever it is. So, and all of them are invalid.
Well, maybe it makes sense if we're the trustee. Maybe it makes sense. They don't need another signature.
Well, you're authorizing yourself to get the funds.
Well, they end up that they do. No, there still has to be someone from their side to enter that contract with you to make it a valid one. Because remember, the all capital letter guy, he can't pick up a piece of a pen and
somebody
put a name
on
paper.
Somebody, some individual has to make the offer.
Absolutely. It's like I was saying earlier. This is the corporation. It can't do anything on its own. And it definitely can't make a contract with me. You know, I've never been anywhere invited to enter a contract by a piece of paper. You know, that would be the same as that wall over there saying, hey, want to enter a contract with me? You know, it's just not physically possible, okay? It has to be a man and a man, or a man and a woman, or a woman and a woman, right? There always has to be the human element involved there. And it has to be one from either side in order for that contract to be created. Now, this is the same, and you can look at it in all the banking that goes on. Okay, when you know, it's you that enter the contracts. They don't. In fact, that's how John Dempsey's been able to be successful, and that's how they were able to get a judgment against the Bank of Nova Scotia, and punitive damages awarded a man in the amount of $2 million. And the injunction against the bank to stop them from harassing him for any kind of money, because they couldn't prove that he had a contract with them, or that they had lent him anything, or that they would lose something if he didn't pay them. They can't prove any of those things. So then the court judgment, you know, created through the notarial protest, and then taken into the American courts and brought up here into the Ontario court for enforcement, that awarded him $2 million and forbade them from ever pressuring him for anything or even talking to him about a mortgage or foreclosure or any of that stuff. Because they couldn't prove that he had a debt with them. Right? And it's the same all the way down the line. Every single one of you, you know, I mean, you always all entered these contracts all by yourself and committed yourself to this debt. And it's fraudulent because they lent you nothing. You know, in fact, what happens? You have to sign a promissory note. And as soon as you do that, you place your autograph on that promissory note, you just authorize the creation of real and lawful money. And then they take that promissory note and they go and sell it right away. And then they get you to pay them still. And all that they really did was lent you the money you already just created. And the Supreme Court of Canada confirmed all of that process in 1978 in a case between the Bank of Montreal and the Bank of Canada, where the Chief Justice acknowledged there is no money in Canada. And he said that an unconditional promise to pay a sum certain in money is itself money. So that's the only thing that can be money. It's a promise to pay it. In other words, an IOU. In case one day some real money comes along and I get some of it, I'll give it to you guys. So I create this promissory note. Right? And that is what you've done. When you enter, when you get a mortgage, you actually create the money yourself. That's what your autograph is capable of doing. It authorizes the creation of the money, because after all, you're the sovereign power. You're the only one with authority to do such a thing, to create money. I mean, that's what these, if we had lawful governments, that's what they would be authorized to do by us. We give that authority to them to create interest-free money based on the wealth of this country. And for those of you who weren't here today earlier, in 1995, the World Bank published an estimate, a report, provided an estimate of Canada's hard natural resource base net worth. Now that's the hard resources. This excludes fresh water, the largest resource out there, excludes oil and gas, including the 70 trillion barrels of oil that's to be extracted from those tar sands, and propane and such as that. We're only talking gold, silver, lead, zinc, nickel, copper, etc. Net worth, raw state, 1995 market value, $2,500 trillion. At that time, that worked out to over $83.3 billion per person in Canada. If you divided that wealth between every man, woman, and child on the planet, it would still be all multi-billionaires.
You could eat well every day.
Fairly, yeah. It wouldn't be at McDonald's, that's for sure. Your fillet of fish and fries, trans fats, etc. No, that's the true case. If we had a lawful government, they'd be issuing interest-free currency based on that wealth, and they would issue it by paying for the development and maintenance of the entire infrastructure of the country, just like it said they were supposed to do in the second reading of the British North America Bill. It also said they were supposed to be providing the provincial governments with not only the fixed sums, which would be the transfer payments, but capitation payments, okay? And these were to be like a certain amount for per head for the population of each province. You know, if there was whatever number of people, give the governments $10 for every person in their province, whatever it is, $10 for simplicity. And that would allow those governments to then provide an equal level of social programs to everyone free of charge. All your health care and all your education for free. Just like international human rights law says, you're already supposed to be getting. How many people here get all their health care for free? Including all the medicines and everything. Not just going to see a doctor. Because okay? You're not supposed to have to pay for any of that.
You mean this is the medicines that kill you?
No.
Exactly.
And don't worry, because soon they're going to be on the controlled drugs and controlled substances and hazardous waste list. Because okay? Natural preventative medicines will be forwarded out there. Anyways, let me get back to this here, to the challenge of, to the request for remedial action, as
good
I
stuff.
Sent to the High Commissioner for Human Rights. This was in July 2003. That was the man Sergio Villar de Mayo, and as I said, I investigated him thoroughly. For the past 30 years prior to this, he had been out there and doing truly noble and just things for the human race and doing it successfully, because he was totally dedicated to this and was truly a well-principled and highly principled man with strong ethics and morals. And I wrote to him. Well, I had no idea he was going to be murdered. But what this actually proved was that all these documents in here prove, all of these things listed here, that there is no government, okay? That we have no laws. We are all left basically on our own, although we're still subject to these de facto governments. We're all basically left on our own with only ourselves as the highest authorities, okay, to make our own laws. And we just hope that we, you know, exercise that ability by doing unto others as they would do it, as we'd have them do unto us. Unfortunately, that's not what's happening. That's also why you're seeing them, increase the number of police everywhere. That's why you're seeing these gun laws and everything. I mean, I hope you've also seen the bumper sticker that if you outlaw guns, only outlaws will have guns. Okay, and that's exactly what's happened. I mean, out in D.C., we've got this, these cops out there, the RCMP and the Vancouver City cops, just those two forces, just in the lower mainland of Vancouver and a couple of the surrounding suburb areas like Surrey and British Columbia, 7 deaths from tasers by those cops. 7, right there, in one little geographic area. Because they've just gone nuts with these things. You know, they just love the opportunity to give someone some pain. These guys are totally, you know, power mongers. And it's unfortunate that, you know, they're just as ignorant actually as the majority of the rest of the population. In fact, that goes the same for all of their operatives throughout their corporate structure. The CRA and everybody else. Collection officers only are required to know 2 sections of the Income Tax Act. So they keep them compartmentalized in this little box. This is all you need to know. And you get paid this money. But why would they say, oh no, I want to know it all. You know, all 3,800 whatever pages. They only need to know 2 sections. They have no idea. Now I've got that admitted to me by collection officers. So they keep them all ignorant, and that's the only way that they could get them to continue to do what they do to us. Keep them ignorant and have them believe that what they're doing is righteous and just. When in fact, what they're doing is violating our human rights every day of the week. Okay? Because we're not living under a lawful system of social order. We're being subjected to corporate copyright-protected corporate policies. We're being treated as corporate entities and made liable for all of the, you know, what the offenses that they've created. We're made liable for all of those and caused to pay one way or another. And we don't have to be doing this. Obviously, they're not a government that's there to serve us. They've got us serving them, and we're basically just nothing more than their collateral. They use us to get lines of credit from the International Monetary Fund because of our ability to go out and work our asses off all our life and give most of what we earn to them. So it doesn't need to be that way, and it's not going to be for much longer. So here we, all of these things, illegal condition anarchy, all governments are unlawful corporate governments de facto. The term de facto is made clear by the Canadian Law Dictionary definition of de facto and de jure. And de facto is just as a matter of fact, or of conduct, or practice, but it's not something that's founded on law. Okay? It's used in contrast to the word or term de jure, which means lawful, legitimate, founded on law. De facto, matter of conduct or practice not founded on law. You're going to see even more evidence of the fraudulent status of all of their instruments, all their acts of parliament, because they're all given, or they're all given royal assent by someone who's in de facto possession of the authority to give royal assent. In other words, her authority is not founded on law. And that's the Governor General, head of state. So they're all fraudulent, not founded on law, so they're all outlaws. And all statutes, including the Criminal Code of Canada, apply only to artificial persons created by the corporate governments de facto. And artificial persons are like, you know, terms created in their law. Mayor, councilman, shipper, receiver, manager, corporation director, you know, all of these terms, right? These are artificial persons. I mean, you weren't born and your mother didn't jump up and down and go, oh, look, I've given birth to a beautiful little corporation director, you know, right? No, I've given birth to a little boy or a little girl, right? These other terminologies come along later, and where do they come from? They're corporate policies. So here we have that all they're all their human rights have been waived unknowingly, because they unknowingly entered master-servant employment relationships under implied contracts of service. That's how they get you to do it. You go out there and you don't care what, you don't even know about this different types of employment relationships that are available, and you're just glad to get a job, most people, right? And you enter into this implied contract of service. Now, I don't know about Ontario, but in BC, their corporate BC Human Rights Code states that it applies to 3 types of employment relationships: master-servant, master-apprentice, and principal-agent. Now, I don't know about you guys, but the only one of those that sounds even close to healthy for me is principal agent. And under that kind of employment relationship, there's the principal, that's the guy who will hire you to perform certain duties for him, and then he'll be willing to compensate you for doing it as his agent. Okay? So you are now an independent agent working for him under this contract, like a contract for hire, as opposed to a contract of service. If you're in service, it's obvious, you know, you're in servitude, you're a slave, you got a master, right? I don't like that at all, and we don't even need to be there. Well, we should all be exercising our natural right to unlimited contract, not ones that they impose upon us. So all individuals have been deceptively denied their third natural right to one's own property, and no avenue of resolve is available domestically, as all courts are courts of commerce, not of law. Numerous crimes against humanity, including but not limited to occupation and subjugation by and to agents of a foreign power. And that's what they all are. They all give their allegiance to this queen, not to you. Oh, I mean, excuse me, I thought we were the sovereign, we're the highest authority. How come you're not giving your allegiance to us if you're truly there to serve us? Right? No, they all give their allegiance to this foreign monarch. And all of that is in contravention and contradiction of the Declaration on the Granting of Independence to Colonial Countries and their People, wherein it states that the subjugation and exploitation, domination of peoples by a foreign power or agents of a foreign power is a gross violation of their human rights and fundamental freedoms. That's what you do all day. You go out and work, and you're being exploited, and all the taxes you're paying every day are all levied on you in the name of the Queen. And then if you don't pay these, then they'll bring charges against you in the name of the Queen. Well, who the hell's the Queen? She's got nothing to do with us. The only one that the Queen is bound to in any way are the original people here, who she is bound to through her predecessors' royal proclamations, where certain guarantees and protections were made for all of the original people. Okay, and of course, that's all been disregarded as well. Plus, they were guaranteed royalties, you know, for natural resources extracted from their land and all of this. They've never been paid a penny, ever. And I mean, that goes back to 1763. So there's a huge claim coming up. Okay, anyways, I go through, I just briefly explain to him, you know, who I am, what I've been doing, how I got to where I am now. And I go through all of the different things in here, like the employment of the word include in all of these interpretation sections. I go through the Statute of Westminster, which is made clear by one of their own, a member of parliament, 14-year member of parliament, Walter Poole. And this is actually the transcript of the House of Commons debates from November 8, 1945, when he presented the results of his work that he did along with other eminent legal experts in interpreting the effects of the Statute of Westminster, 1931, on the temporary agreement that had been created by the British North America Act. And he showed them in here, well, there's his whole political history. He showed them in here that he gave all the definitions for a federal union, and it was not his, they were from authorities, right? Federal union was desired, but guess what? Canada not federated under the BNA Act. That was not legally possible. They had to already have been in direct control of the sovereign power at the time that they chose to come into this confederation. Okay? But of course they weren't. They were operating on delegated power from some foreign monarch. So legally, they could not have created a confederation. And then he goes on to say right here, provinces completely sovereign ever since the Statute of Westminster, and that Canada doesn't have a constitution, never did. So how could there be all of a sudden be a government? You know, I mean, after the Statute of Westminster, everything was supposed to change. Should have been referendums in every province. Everyone should have had the opportunity to express their desires and wishes as to, you know, creating a federal state of governance. None of that was ever done. In fact, nobody was ever even told about the Statute of Westminster. Again, they just got lawyers that paid them off to write us opinions saying that it wasn't legally possible for the monarchy to abdicate his sovereign power. Now, Peter Hogg, who is now considered the constitutional law expert of Canada, according to their own House of Commons. By the way, Walter Cool, he was considered the constitutional law expert of the time, back in 1945. But you know what? They just shat on him throughout this whole presentation. Scoffed and humiliated him, and you know, same thing that happened in 1930. They didn't like what they were hearing because he was telling them basically, we don't have any authority. All of the authority is in the hands of the provinces because this central legislature was dissolved. In fact, somewhere in here he says something to the effect, gentlemen, I believe the people of Canada have the absolute right to know exactly under whose authority they're living. And I can assure you, gentlemen, it is not ours. It's not our authority. We don't have it. So he goes on and he's even got his own little publication, which I've blown up to make 8.5 by 11. It's otherwise just a small little booklet, half the page. He's got the original draft of the British North American Bill, first page. And right over here, he's got the Statute of Westminster, an explanation of it. And then pertinent clauses from that statute and other statutes. But here he's got a letter written to Honorable Rennie Levesque. Okay? And this was right after he was elected with the Separatist Party, right, for Quebec. And he raised him, congratulations on your magnificent personal victory that your party Quebecois in the recent Quebec election. And he starts talking about him, how he's been involved, and he's had this, been in service to the government for 14 years, blah, blah, blah. And over here he starts talking about, so far as separation is concerned, rather than it being necessary to seek separation rights through a referendum, the province of Quebec is already completely constitutionally separated from the rest of Canada. And he goes on to say down here, how can you be divorced if you've never been married? Okay, because there was never a lawful confederation. You were never part of Canada. It was just a temporary agreement to have all of the colonies at the time unite so that they would have strength in numbers in warding off the military assaults made by the United States of America forces trying to take over up here, right? But in fact, and as I stated earlier to everyone, thanks to the original people, the natives here, who trained the French Canadians in guerrilla warfare and how to fight at night and in the swamps and everything else, they were able to go out there, 700 or 800 of them, and wipe out a couple of thousand U.S. troops. In fact, there was one raid where there's 10,000 U.S. troops came up. There was about 1,400 Indians and French Canadian combined who went out there, killed 5,000 of them, sent the other 5,000 home, half of them wounded and all of them in shame. And in fact, Canada, in quotations, okay, is the only country that the United States, in their history of warring, that they've ever commenced war against or conducted a war against where they have not gained one square inch of geography through military conquest. And it's thanks to the original people here at the time. Okay? If it had not been for them, you would have been Americans a long, long time ago and serving George Bush. I hope you're not disappointed. Anyways, so that's Walter Cool's presentation. Now we have, I don't want to find it here, this Governor General. Now don't forget, when the Statute of Westminster went through, was passed, it made that office redundant because the monarchy had effectively removed itself from the equation. So without that need for a liaison between the monarchy and the Governor General, that office was eliminated. I really want to show you this. I'm going to have to just hold this up to save some time here. In the binder here on this page, we've got right from the Governor General's own website, role and responsibilities of the Governor General. And here's that picture of that woman who used to have that TV show, you know, about planting flowers and stuff, Adrienne Clarkson, right? Who somehow ended up Governor General. And it says right here, though, she's Canada's de facto head of state. Well, the head of state is the entity from which all governments get their authority. The head of state is the one who actually gives royal assent to all acts of parliament, and thereby makes them law, or what they call law, right? Now, if she's in de facto possession of that authority, that means that her authority is not founded on law. In fact, there is no evidence, and you can write to the Privy Council in England, like the people in Australia have done, and you can get confirmation that there's never been an appointment by the Queen, ever, for a Governor General, or for her to act as head of state. And of course, that's why she's de facto, not founded on law, because the Queen can't do that. The Queen hasn't had any authority since 1931, at least. And in fact, if you look back further in this B&A Act, you'll see that in 1896, Queen Victoria repealed Section 2 of this Act, which stated that any reference to the Queen or, you know, Her Majesty or anything like that was also a reference to her heirs and successors. Okay, the provision of the Act referring to Her Majesty, the Queen, extend also to the heirs and successors of Her Majesty, kings and queens of the United Kingdom of Great Britain and Ireland. That was repealed. That's no longer in there, ever since 1896. So when Queen Victoria died in 1901, that was the end of any meaning given to the term queen in this document. So that's when it really ended. That's when the queen was kind of removed from this document. Because now when you look in here, even after 1982, when Trudeau was over there, if this is truly a sovereign nation, how come it still says in here, under Section 91, powers of the Parliament, that it shall be lawful for the Queen, by and with the advice and consent of the Senate and House of Commons, to make laws for the peace, order, and good government of Canada. So it still says it's the Queen that can make the laws. And yet, the provision in here that allows you to look at that term Queen and connect it with this Queen Elizabeth, that's gone. So the word Queen here means really nothing. But they didn't amend it in 1982 when they went to all the trouble of renaming this and creating a Constitution Act and a Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms, which, by the way, is not Canadian at all, of course, because it was passed in the United Kingdom Parliament. And that's also confirmed, by the way, in this little binder, where Peter Hogg, that constitutional law expert I told you about, he is the Dean of Osgoode Hall Law School at York University, and he wrote a book, and in it he talks about that repatriation of the Constitution. And, oh, I'm sorry, here we go. And he says, as far as the Queen goes, don't forget, all the taxes are levied in her name and all criminal charges are brought in her name. Like as if she had some kind of lawful authority, right? Here he goes. He says, this is right from his book, Constitutional Law of Canada. For practical purposes, however, the Queen's role for Canada is primarily, in other words, the number one most significant role she has as a ceremonial head of the Commonwealth being an informal association of countries that were formerly members of the old British Empire. Ceremonial, informal, formerly, and old. Sounds like a whole lot of lawful authority, right? Not. So that's who she is. Nobody. Easter Bunny wearing a crown. Okay, that's how powerful and lawful, and much lawful authority she's got. Now further down, he refers to this, what I said about this so-called Canadian Charter of Rights. He says, at first blush, it does not seem plausible to regard the enactment of the Canada Act 1982 and the Constitution Act 1982 as a patriation of the Canadian Constitution. Their enactment added two more imperial statutes. Now, imperial means ever having to do with a monarch, the United Kingdom, right? To the series that existed before. Since 1982, more, not less, of Canada's Constitution is to be found in the statute book of the United Kingdom. So how do they get away with calling that a Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms? You know, another fraud. Not only that, it doesn't really matter to you or I anyhow, because if you look at the legal definition of the term citizen, to see that it's a person who owes allegiance to the state, spelled capital S, and is guaranteed certain rights. And what are those rights that you're guaranteed? Those certain rights? Those ones under that dictative rights and freedoms that they call a charter. Nothing about human rights, because if you look in there, or any other statute out there, you'll find you don't have the right to own property. It's not written anywhere. The Canadian Bill of Rights says you've got the right to enjoyment of property. Didn't tell you whose. Okay? But not to own it. Only to enjoy it. Of course, to also pay for it, be liable for it. Right? But you don't have the right anywhere guaranteed you by any of their domestic statutes to actually own it yourself. Now that is, of course, guaranteed under international human rights instruments. So, and it's, well, it's your third natural right. So I put that whole thing together, and of course, like I said, he was murdered. I've now been disseminating this, and I found another use for it. I wanted to try and create a process whereby I could use this and put this in the government's face and say, prove to me that what it says in here is wrong. Show me evidence that's contrary to what I've, you know, been able to interpret this as saying. That you guys are pure corporations, all your stuff is copyright protected, it only applies to the corporate entities that your corporate policies have created, and it only applies within the geographic boundaries of your corporation. Prove to me that that's wrong. So I created a process called challenge, notice of challenge of jurisdiction and lawful authority. And that challenge has now been served on them by dozens of people. And again, everybody who has used this challenge, it also goes in, of course, with this entire binder, served on the attorney generals. They're the supposedly the chief law enforcement officers of Canada and the provinces. Everybody who's served one has not received a response from them. Well, I want to tell you, we've made them subject to not only what's called tacit agreement or tacit consent, all right? Because they do that to us. That's how they got all of you, or most of you, involved in their programs, because you didn't say no to them. It's deemed that you said yes. So in other words, by your silence, you agreed. And that, by the way, is a legal maxim. He who is silent is understood to agree. So as long as you just sit back and don't say no to them, you've said yes. Okay? And that's even evidenced in the Supreme Court rules in British Columbia, Supreme Court of British Columbia, Rule 1910, entitled Status Admitted. If the corporation of a party or the corporate status of a party is not specifically denied, it is deemed to have been admitted. So when you walk in their court, if you don't have an affidavit in your hand that's saying, I deny being anything other than a naturally created man or woman, right, you're going to be treated as a corporation, as a corporate entity, because you didn't say, no, I'm not. So they say, well, you've said, yes, you are. So now we can send you to our court of commerce and our corporate policies. So all this evidence just keeps adding up and adding up and adding up, and it's undeniable now, because these challenges have been served by dozens of people, and not once have we received a response. They've been made subject to not only that tacit, that legal maxim, he who is silent is understood to agree, that's called giving tacit agreement or consent to something, and then also, though, to what is called estoppel. And I'm just going to get to, I got to go right over here to this now. Get this turned on. Pat, where are you? Did he take off?
Just outside your door.
Yeah. You got to do that too, I guess. I don't need this one. I'm just going to look and get it operating. Get that tap. Just going to boot this up, but. I'm going to show you what this challenge is that has now been served. After all these dozens of other people, never received a response from these guys at all. The only response we ever did receive actually was from an assistant or a secretary to some assistant deputy commissioner or something in the CRA who came back saying that, you know, the federal government has the constitutional right to levy income taxes and sent us a copy of their tax myths off their website, right? Okay, so that was not a response to the challenge of jurisdiction, right? And that's why now I've incorporated that right into the challenge. It's the very first line says, this is not a, quote, challenge of the federal government's constitutional right to levy income taxes. Here we go. Let me see here. Yeah, okay, that's still hooked up. And I want to get into this USB. Where is it? What do we got here?
This morning.
So we've made them subject to what's called estoppel. Now, estoppel, according to the Canadian Law Dictionary, is a substantive rule of law and principle of justice and equity. And estoppel by in paw basically means estoppel by conduct. We're all judged by our conduct. And so when they fail, neglect, or refuse to respond, by that conduct, they've told us we're admitting to everything you say. Okay? And that's what I'll just show you here what the definition of estoppel is. Here's the actual challenge. Okay. This is May 7th, 2007. This was drafted and sent, and it was with my return address up here. Just let me see if I can. My return address up here, and it's addressed to Robert Nicholson, Natural Man, Attorney General of Canada, and Wally Opal, Natural Man, Attorney General of the Province of British Columbia, in care of, and Attorney General of the Capital T Province, and up here it's in care of the Minister of Justice, Attorney General of Canada, and that this challenge is made on behalf of Capilano, legal name Jerry Johnson, Hereditary Chief of the Squamish Nation, Senclee, legal name Alex Louis, headman of and spokesman for the Kuskwelex tribal lands. Skookumanik, legal name Pierre Kruger, headman, spokesman for Kuskwelex tribal lands. And any response shall be delivered to David Butterfield at the address above. So we get into here, and like I said right off the bat, I let them know this is not a challenge of the federal government's constitutional right to levy income taxes. We advise them. You are hereby required to prove the lawful authority and lawful jurisdiction of both the federal government of Canada and the government of the province, capital P, of British Columbia. Further take notice, the evidence provided here in this challenge of jurisdiction and lawful authority is conclusive proof that all levels of government are merely and purely 100% corporations and are not lawfully constituted governments, which would be capable of passing and enforcing public laws. Instead, your corporate governments de facto have created only copyright-protected private corporate policies, having jurisdiction only over artificial persons created by those corporate policies, referred as statutes, and only within the geographical boundaries of the respective corporation. I'm going to show you one example of that here. I just had it. I hope I can grab it again quickly. There's actually the signed bylaws from the city of Surrey, and I'm not going to find it out. Anyways, it just says that these bylaws apply to all private property within the capital C city of Surrey. So that's within the corporation. Now, Walmart's geographic boundaries are, of course, only the size of their building, their store, and their parking lot. their corporate policies don't apply to the people across the street or down the block or on the other side of the city. And since they're these corporation governments' own definition of corporation identifies themselves right in there with companies, societies, organizations. They don't make any distinction saying, you know, municipality, except that a municipality can tax everyone or make bylaws. You know, they don't give any distinction like that. They identify themselves clearly as pure corporations, so right along with all the other ones that are out there. Okay, so they've done that. And of course, like Walmart, you know, their corporate policies cannot apply anywhere outside their own geographical boundaries. Well, guess what? It says that in all these statutes. But then I guess you guys don't sit around on Sunday afternoon reading statutes, do you? You know, I mean, who would? Except me. Yeah. What's wrong with me? Anyways, even further, take notice. You're hereby required, upon your failure, neglect, or refusal to respond appropriately to this challenge, to immediately provide notice to all your agents, giving direction that they cease and desist any further actions constituting malicious vexation by legal process. Said notice must give proper direction, I should say, to restrict enforcement of all your de facto corporate government's policies, bracket statutes, only to natural men and women who voluntarily and with knowledge act in capacity of an artificial person within and to the service of the corporate government's de facto. In other words, you can only apply these things to people who work in your corporation. Okay? And that's the directive you've got to give to all your agents, that's who these statutes can be applied to. And I said, if any of you are capable or are somehow capable of providing valid evidential documentation contrary to the facts contained herein, you must do so within 20 days of your receipt of this challenge, if you wish to avoid provision of your tacit agreement and subjection to estoppel by conduct. Now here, tell them about the effective disregard. And that, should you fail, neglect, or refuse to respond appropriately to this challenge, you will tacitly agree with all facts contained herein. The application of the Nuremberg principles will cause you, the man or woman, in your private capacity, to answer to an international human rights tribunal on charges including aiding the operation of a form of slavery. Confirmation of the gross human rights violations which all of you perpetrate against all people who live without knowledge comes from the facts presented herein. Know this, whether or not you are able or willing to respond to this challenge, this great deception, carried out with genocidal intent, will be completely exposed to the Human Rights Tribunal and the world. Then we give them the definition of estoppel, just so that they can, you know, plead ignorance, as if it's an excuse. So here, it's originally known as a preclusion, a bar, an impairment, whereby a party is precluded in any subsequent proceeding, not necessarily ones that these people who made this challenge are involved in, any subsequent proceeding. Because we got them to plead guilty now, okay? They don't need to plead guilty to these guys and then have you guys come along and have to plead guilty to you as well. We already got their guilty plea. And all of you can now take advantage of this. All of you. None of you have to serve this challenge. It's a done deal. It's over, okay? They've admitted this. So, let's see, down here, the whole concept is more precisely viewed as a substantive rule of law, a principle of justice and equity. And there's the case law to confirm that. Okay? There are four kinds of estoppel. And what we're doing is applying the estoppel in paw, and which means estoppel by conduct. And that's the usual meaning of the word. When one person, by his conduct, okay, or by his silence, gives the appearance, or leads another to believe, rather, that certain facts are true and these are acted upon, then in any subsequent proceeding, this person cannot deny the truth of those facts. So once he's given the appearance that the facts in that challenge are true, he will never be allowed to ever try and deny them again. He's now zipper-lipped. Okay? And he's, by their silence, both the Attorney General of Canada and the province, by not answering and saying no, They've said yes to all of those facts. They are a corporation, they are violating your human rights and mine, and they're all corporate policies that only apply within their corporation. They've defrauded all the people, they've stolen all the land and stolen all the resources, and of course it's all to their own commercial gain, okay? And that's what they've now admitted. So what are we gonna do with this? Well, we've got, thanks to Pat, and to John Dempsey and to Derek, who are all notaries. We've now, this, by the way, this whole process, this challenge was all notarized, which gave it legal force and effect when served on them. I'm just going to take you right to the end page here where we gave them the warning. It's a 10-page long document. There's eight. And here we gave them some of the definitions. I'm not used to this finger pad on Pat's computer here. Okay, we gave him this warning. You're now in possession of the factual truths relative to the ungoverned status of all geographic areas commonly called provinces and the de facto corporate status held by the governments. You are now aware of the restricted jurisdiction / authority held by these corporate governments de facto according to their so-called laws. If you were, you are no longer ignorant. You now possess enough evidence to cause any individual of good conscience and morals to work to create lawful governments. As you now possess this knowledge, should you carry out any further activities on behalf of or in the name of the corporate government de facto without first providing valid contrary evidence, then by your own free will, you will act to violate human rights. Choosing to continue business as usual in spite of your inability to disprove the facts contained herein tells us you do so while having knowledge that what you do is unlawful. Referred to in law as mens rea, or having a guilty mind with intent to commit a crime. You thereby provide your signed confessions. So that's the kind of effect that this rule of law estoppel by conduct has. And that the legal maxim, he who is silent is understood to agree. Combined together, it's very powerful, and they're told right there that estoppel shall apply. The 20 calendar day period allowed for response to this challenge will commence on the date of your receipt of these documents. Should any of you, as natural men or women, fail, neglect, or refuse to respond as required, that failure, neglect, or refusal will be your tacit agreement with all facts provided herein, and your tacit admittance that the purely corporate governments have never possessed lawful authority outside their own geographic boundaries, i.e. City Hall. Legal actions will then commence against all involved, jointly and severally, in their private capacities as natural men and women, to bring them before an international human rights tribunal. Further to that, international declarations and claims will be filed with all appropriate bodies. And it was all autographed and affirmed by notary before it was sent off. Actually, I've got all the copies in my briefcase over there with the notary symbols or stickers and everything on there and their seal. Now, what ended up happening? Well, they didn't respond. So, and since they were supposed to respond to me, I'm the one who can prepare and affirm an affidavit of non-response. And I, of course, did this with the notary affirming it, and the same notary who affirmed the challenge, so he's followed the whole process through. And this affidavit, this one here was served to Robert Douglas Nicholson, and it was served some time ago, about a month ago now. And it refers to the challenge of jurisdiction and lawful authority authorized and made on behalf of Capilano and St. Cleve and Skookumanik, and that any response was to have been delivered to me. That the challenge provided a binder, which, amongst other legal documents, was including copies of the interpretation sections of statutory instruments such as the Canada Land Survey Act. I hereby affirm that the 10 pages attached here to and marked as Exhibit A to this affidavit is a true copy of the letter of challenge sent to the above-named recipient. So I'm now confirmed right there that we served this on him, and it was served on him by Canada Post. We've got all those numbers, the Express Post registration numbers. This was served by Purelator, and actually when it was when it went into Purolator, I changed that, okay, from Express Post to Purolator and put the Purolator PIN number right on the front page of the document. Mm-hmm. I have copies of all of that too. That amongst the unlawful conditions and facts admitted and conceded by Robert Douglas Nicholson's failure to respond to the challenge are as follows. The geographic areas commonly called provinces are not a part of Canada and are now, as they have always been, sovereign territories of the various nations of the original people of Turtle Island. The recipient is an officer of a corporate government de facto. The de facto government of Canada's copyright protected and therefore private corporate policies referred to statutes have jurisdiction only over officers slash servants of that corporate government de facto and apply only within the geographic boundaries of that de facto corporate government. The individuals acting as agents of the de facto corporate government of Canada have committed and continue to commit numerous and treasonous acts of fraud against all original people. Because, of course, the Queen owes allegiance to all the original people here through the Royal Proclamation. Then she gets these guys, who all owe allegiance to the Queen, to go out and attack the very ones that the Queen owes allegiance to. That is treasonous, because they're going after the ones the Queen sworn to protect. Right? So they're in direct treasonous actions there. And every time that they do anything to any one of the original people here, that's what it is. Okay? As well as the fact they're just a corporation and don't have any lawful authority. So anyone who's ever been arrested has been, number one, kidnapped, number two, unlawfully confined, right? And all of this is not just these criminal activities, but they're also violations of their human rights. You know, you can't be arrested and thrown into jail, but like I can't walk up to you and do that and say, hey, well, I'm the authority here, you know, because I got this corporation behind me. No, especially if I'm only relying on a corporate policy that, according to this criminal code, it only applies in the Northwest Yukon and Nunavut. Because it's the criminal code of Canada, and it doesn't redefine the term province. Okay? So, this is no, illusion or something that I'm really stretching the envelope on. No, this is all factual. You can only read these things one way, and that's how they're intended to be read, one way. Because all law has got to be written in clear and unambiguous language if anyone's expected to understand it. Of course, they made sure that in the interpretation sections you were going to get confused by that word includes. Well, their code's been busted, the cat's out of the bag. Okay? They cannot catch that cat to put it back in the bag. It's all over for them. It's just a matter of us clearing up some paperwork here. And that's what we're in the midst of doing. This is a big part of it right here. So they have admitted all of these things, including that the Office of the Governor General was rendered redundant, and all subsequent holders of that office have acted as Canada's de facto head of state, as confirmed on the website operated by that office. That as a result of the de facto status of the head of state, each act of giving royal assent to any act of Parliament was not founded on law, and therefore every such act is rendered completely unlawful and without any force or effect. In fact, other than the only force or effect is to violate more human rights. So they gave him 20 days, he didn't respond, the rule of law and principle of justice and equity estoppel would apply, and which now does apply. So, we got all of this served on him, all affirmed, within the sovereign territory of the Squamish Nation of original people, right? Because that's a valid territory, and it's now been recognized as such by the Attorney General of Canada and the province of British Columbia, because they did not contest this at all. So that land is undisputedly that of the sovereign territory of those original people. And we should all thank our lucky stars for that, because these people are believing in us all being their brothers and sisters, and they're not going to discriminate against us like most of the white men have done against them. And it was myself 3 years ago, after completing all this work on this stuff and realizing that the only ones who have ever had a lawful system of social order in this land are those of the original people. They're the only ones. Because there's no evidence anywhere at all that there's ever been a country called Canada, that there's ever been a government of Canada, that there's ever been a government of any one of these provinces, or that, in fact, there was ever any real provinces of geographic areas, right? No evidence of that. So theirs is the only one that's ever, or they're the only ones who have ever had a lawful system of governance in place. Yes?
Now, you just said there's no Canada. Didn't you say?
I'm sorry, I can't hear you.
Didn't you say, you just said that there actually is no Canada. Earlier, didn't you say that Canada is defined as Northwest Territory, Yukon, and Nunavut?
In their corporate policy.
Right. So there actually is a Canada, but that's what Canada is, right?
Well, I guess so, if a corporation can be that big. And I'd like to know how they stole that land from all of those original people up there.
So that may be unlawful, too. That may just be a statement.
It's you know, the true fact is that Canada, and again, go and look it up yourself. Go onto the internet, the United States Securities and Exchange Commission, and type in company search Canada, or type in Ontario, province of, and it'll come up for you, all capital letters, and show you right there the conformed company name, Ontario, province of, the conformed company name, Canada. Like I said, I've got a request in to the Securities and Exchange Commission right now, and they referred me already to their contractor who provides documents to people on their request. I've got a request for documents identifying the owners of these corporations, because those are the guys who we are ultimately going to be serving judgments and claims on. Okay? And the claims are not going to be for $1.4 billion like the one that we're now have in our possession, that is going across a, sorry, just one sec, okay, that is to going across the border down into the sovereign Tuscarora territory where we're going to be deposited in a bank. Okay. Yes?
Who do you suspect are the owners of these corporations?
Oh, I know who it is. It's these international money powers. They're the ones who created all of these corporate governments. And the reason they did it way back when was to displace natural law and to impose their laws of commerce on everyone.
So it'll be another corporation that owns it?
Well, if Lionel Nathan Rothschild, the original owner, you know, who by fraudulent means gained control of the Central Bank of England, but if his descendants or any of the Rockefellers, or there's actually about 12 others in there that are involved in the ownership of these central banking systems, they are the ones. Their names will likely be on these documents.
So do you expect the U.S. Securities and Exchange Commission to come up with those names?
Well, that's what their contractor is there to do, and they've given me a number and everything else, you know, a request number and all of this, give me the contractor's name, and said that they should be contacting within this time frame. If I don't hear from them, here's the 1-800 phone number. You can contact them directly yourself. Okay? So, yeah, that's what we're going after. You know, and if I have to, I'll use an FOI, a Freedom of Information, to get it out of them. Yes?
Isn't there a right that you have a trust or a corporation?
Probably have an entity that owns it.
You don't have to reveal
then
who are
then what do you do? You can't go after the natural person.
Oh, there is if you're in some kind of an offshore country, I guess, that's got those kind of international business corporation, you know, laws protecting that kind of information. You know, like an IBC, well, actually, we've now got a different form of IBC. It's not an international business corporation, it's an Indian business corporation. So, but in those kinds of conditions, yeah, that then, no, they don't have to disclose who the directors are or the principals of the corporation.
Yeah, I read somewhere a while back, I don't know if this is true enough, that the United States is basically owned by the Virginia Corporation. That's the corporation they started before, you know, supposedly the sham of American independence was created, that they created ownership of the lands of the United States, the original colonies, to the Virginia Corporation. Supposedly, the Virginia Corporation is controlled by the U.S.
Exactly.
Well, they're controlled by the Pope.
Of course, yeah. And is that the white Pope or the black Pope?
I don't know, but it's somewhere in Rome.
Because the black Pope is the guy who is at the top of all of them. Yeah, he's the one they all answer to. But as far as what you said there, that's probably absolutely correct. Because I believe that the Corporation Canada, from all the evidence, was set up to compete with the Hudson's Bay Corporation and the Northwest Trading Corporation, and to rape the land of its wealth of resources and send the revenues back to their Canada's corporate master, the Crown. Okay, that 6.44 square acres in the center of the city of London. Okay.
Yeah. Fur, we talked about that last time, you were about fur in Black's Law Dictionary.
Fur trader?
Fur traders, fur, F-U-R,
right.
Defined as a thief.
Yep.
That's what it means and what it means.
So you have thief traders, right? So anyways, let me just get on to it here with this. So now that was the one to the Attorney General of Canada, or pardon me, that was actually Wally Opal. Then there's the Canada, we've got a judgment in an estoppel here. And this is what we're currently in the midst of processing. And this is all the notarized protest, okay? Here's the certificate of dishonor, judgment by estoppel, okay? And this is being prepared by Pat, right here, Pat Hawley, he's as the notary. There's the international registered mail number right there that this will be sent with, identifying the challenge of jurisdiction and lawful authority. The notice of non-response, which is actually affidavit of non-response. And in the end of it, we basically got this, this is a judgment now against them. Okay? That we can now, well, if we had the court up and running right now, I'd be stamping this thing tonight, okay, making this a court judgment. Okay? So, and that's what we have the ability to do, and then because, of course, Canada is a subsidiary corporation, or the province is a subsidiary corporation in the United States, the courts here are inferior to their courts. And when we bring a judgment up here, just as it had already been done, bring it right into their superior court here and have it enforced. And they're bound to do it. They have to have their sheriffs enforce this. And if we issue a claim or want to bring liens and or make force their sheriffs to go and seize and sell property belonging to these individuals like Nicholson, or if we want to apply a lien to those parliament buildings or the land titles offices, because we're going to have claims, not for $1.4 billion, as I started to say earlier, but by the time we've got all of the original people across the land united, and I'm going to show you here a Declaration of Independence we've prepared, and we've already got probably 50 to 80 hereditary chiefs ready to sign on it, okay? And to unite all of them, to also allow them all to forget about their little squabbles with each other, you know, whose territory really this is, you know, we got a map showing that we go 4 miles over that way, and your map says that you're 2 miles over this way, and forget about all of that stuff, because we're going to unite, forget all of those little differences, and the purpose is, of course, to allow everybody that independence. And the independence is from who? From the corporation. And once that happens, there's going to be, we've already got it in place. We've got, right now we're setting up the court. We're setting up a Uniform Commercial Code filing office down in Michigan on the sovereign territory of the Tuscarora. And this is going to allow us to go after these guys in their private capacities, okay? And, you know, as well as corporate capacities. We're going to be filing claims probably just for the original people in British Columbia who were signed on to this challenge. We were trying to pick a number, you know, like how do you apply a value to all the death, all the destroyed families, cultures, you know, the human rights violations from these being subjected to those in these residential schools, you know, the destruction and inability or allowance to even speak their own languages, okay, let alone theft of all their land and the natural resources, the destruction of the ecologies and environments out there, you know, that are going to take a long, long time to restore. How do you recover from that? What kind of dollar value? I mean, anybody got a blue book on this stuff? You know? So we figure maybe 20 trillion.
2,500 trillion.
Well, this is just the, you know, southwestern corner of the province of British Columbia, right?
Google. I think that's 18 zeros.
It's going to be up there because we figure that by the time we get right across, it's going to easily be $300 to $500 trillion total claims are going to be prepared, and, you know, through this whole protest, just like they already got the $1.4 billion judgment. That's the same process we're using. except there's going to be a much larger amount. Now, that $1.4 billion judgment, as soon as they get it approved to take it across the border by Homeland Security and Interpol, that is $1.4 billion in money that they can now deposit in the bank. Now we can take that judgment and create a bond based on that debt. That's so, because, I mean, that's how banks operate, isn't it? It's their debts that are, or debt owed them, that is their assets. Okay? So we do this basically the same thing. And if you haven't noticed, this is all we're doing all the way through. We're using their stuff and their processes and procedures, the ones that they've used against us all these years, and we're just turning it around and putting it back at them. And, there's nothing they can do about it. Nothing. It's completely legal. It's all done through their courts, etc. So this is what's going to happen. And then we're going to be assisting through creation of bond, and we can sell performance bonds to construction companies and others, and make a lot of real money. And we're going to take that money, and we're going to invest it in the communities, starting with the original people who have been most devastated from all that's gone on. And one of the first things that's going to be done is to bring drinkable water to those more than 100 reserves in this country, Canada, greatest country in the world to live in, where they haven't had water that they can drink. And in fact, most of the people are sick there. There's E. coli and, infections from the water. Could that be because the water is right here and the sewage treatment is right here? It's totally irresponsible. It's absolutely despicable, the conditions that they've been forced to live under. Their children are sick, all the time. They got no healthcare facilities up there to, even look at the children, right?
My family has them on the boil water. They live on the Serpent River, right on the North Shore of Lake Huron, on Highway 17.
And how many years have been on boil water alert? 10, 15?
The non-native community across the river are on provincial water standards, which are much better, and they've got a water treatment plant, but the federal standards guarding the reserve didn't deem it worthy. Plus the pollution of the sulfur plant they put on the reserve and took off and left the hot land, the tainted land there. The uranium mine in Elliott Lake that's seeping down the Serpent River, and the pulp and paper mill that's seeping down the Spanish River and pinching them in between, and they're just left behind.
See, this is the kind of stuff that we need to focus our attentions on immediately. And these are the most gross human rights violations. These people have been denied any kind of, acceptable standards of being alive. They are just suffering every day of their lives, or existence, I should say. So that's got to be changed. And then we're going to, once all the waters, been dealt with, there's going to be, we're going to finance the setting up an operation of our organic farming operations for these communities so that they can grow their own food and have a marketable product and create a little economy for themselves there. Plus, like Pat was talking to you earlier, I guess that he's got all kinds of other ideas for infrastructure. I have...
Hey David, they need to set up for tomorrow morning.
Okay,
we've got to get up. Continue in the restaurant if you want. But Charles is going to tell us how he wants the tables set up real quick.
Okay.
If everybody could just give a hand and help set up the tables where he wants it for allowing us to run a little longer. Okay, Charles?
Okay. Anyways, that's the idea. Is we're going to finance the setting up of all these infrastructures and get that all taken care of so that all of these people, plus we've got a credit union, okay, and like I said, there's going to be interest-free money available for people, right, which will all probably turn into be a totally non-repayable loan, because once we've got this, established a little bit, we're going to be, so all of us are going to have remove all of that financial stress from our lives forever. Okay, because all the taxation will be gone. We'll all be able to, have all of our health care and all of our education. In fact, we're also want to promote and even finance the people's pursuit of all their natural skills and abilities, so you don't have to slave at these jobs you hate or anything like that anymore. Families will be united again, mothers will be able to actually be with their children, and so will fathers in many cases. So it's really going to come down to pretty much being only those who really want to work. And who's going to do all the work? Well, guess what? As of a number of years ago, probably 10, we've had the ability to do 75% of the jobs that are being done by men and women right now can all be done by robots and technologies. Okay? So, because, again, we weren't put here to service corporations all our lives. Okay? We're here to enjoy the wonders of all creation, including each other, and to share all of this with each other. It's a show of courage on your part to come and even think about listening to stuff like this. I know some of it's a big shock for you, but again, thank you, and you know, hang in, because guess what? The light at the end of the tunnel is right there, and it's all going to be busting open real soon for all of us. So, and that's a promise.
There's an announcement too. On Sunday, the Honorable Justice Butterfield will be appearing. 16 Faulkner Drive, Mississauga, Unit 14. Okay, he'll be once again speaking in the Mississauga at 11 a.m. Sunday morning. 16 Faulkner Drive, Mississauga, Unit 14. Most people know it as Paul Gugino's Beyond Kung Fu, and it'll be a very interesting day. He'll continue on it. We're probably going to take about the first 45 minutes and explain the lean process, and then let David go berserk for the rest of the day telling everybody about all the wonderful things. One thing I want to let you know is this is real. It is happening. I've devoted my life to doing this stuff. We've got the infrastructure in place. David gave us the mechanism to take down the serpent. Now we've created the infrastructure to replace it. So what every one of you needs to do is learn how to interact with each other, learn how to love each other, respect each other, and treat others as you want to be treated.
And that includes, of course, forgiving, okay?
And forgive.
Because we've got to forgive. Remember, don't be mad at these people that have oppressed us. They're all ignorant, too. So, you know, they need to be forgiven. You know, we need to help everybody in a healing process here. Because, you know, Lord knows, I mean, we've all been damaged severely throughout our lives by this, by that system that's out there. So, we forgive and we go forward. Sorry, Kat, for interrupting there.
So, everybody, hopefully we'll see you at Sunday in Mississauga.